morning. Welcome everybody that's viewing on Facebook this morning. I'm Pastor Bob Nakamura of Springwater Baptist Church. Wow, what a week. It's a couple weeks it's been since we've been ordered to stay home and not be able to come together and worship. This is one of the good things about social media and having the technology to be able to broadcast and still to have an opportunity to. The Bible tells us not to forsake the assembling together of ourselves as a manner of some is, but to exhort one another, and so much the more as we see the day approaching. And even though we're not together in person, at least this way we're able to fellowship together via the internet. And Lord willing, that each and every one of you who view today's message or any message that's streaming on social media, that you are encouraged in the time that which we live, because it's a different time and day right now that for most of us we've never experienced anything like this. And we look at what's going on in the world today and how the world turns to human wisdom and knowledge to take care of the issues that they're confronted with. But for everyone who has trusted Jesus Christ as their Lord, Savior, and Master of their lives, has a different view. We call it a biblical worldview. And thank God we have the Word of God to go to and to get encouragement, to get instruction, and to see the truths that God has provided for us in His Word, that we have a place to go. And He's given us the Spirit of God, so now we have the ability to understand what the Word of God says. And that's a wonderful thing, because a person that doesn't know Jesus Christ does not have the ability to truly comprehend and understand what the Word of God says. It takes the Spirit of God that dwells within every believer to really grasp hold of what the Word of God is trying to show us. When I think about the coronavirus and how small it is, it's microscopic in size, and to the naked eye, we can't see it. And I kind of look at that this morning as an unknown enemy. It's one that we can't see. It's called a disease, but for most of us, unless we have the ability to see those microscopic cells, it's an unseen enemy. But not only do we have an unseen enemy here in the physical realm, we have an unseen enemy in the spiritual realm, and that's called the devil. And the devil is doing his best to invoke fear into not just the regular world, everybody around us, but into the church, into the hearts of Bible-believing Christians. But 2 Timothy chapter 1, verse 7 says, "Is for God hath not given us a spirit of fear, but of power and of love and a sound mind." So when I look at the spiritual warfare that's going on, we have, as children of God, some anchors that will hold. And that's where I want to go this morning, is to remind believers and to tell others that do not believe that there's an anchor available, that for every person who's trusted Jesus Christ as their Lord, Savior, and Master, they have anchors that they can trust on, anchors that will hold in the time of storm. And the message this morning is going to be based on the book of Acts chapter 27. It's a time when the Apostle Paul was in a storm, literally in a storm out at sea. And if you've ever been in turbulent waters during a storm, that's a scary thing. In fact, that's a time when maybe your life might even come before you at speed, because you just don't know if you're going to make it out of it. But here's what it says in Acts chapter 27, verses 24 and 25. Actually, I'm going to start in verse 23. It says, "For there stood by me this night the angel of God, whose I am and whom I serve, saying, Fear not, Paul, thou must be brought before Caesar, and lo, God hath given thee all them that sail with thee. Wherefore, sirs, be of good cheer, for I believe God that it shall be even as it was told me." That beautiful statement in verse 23 that says that night the angel of God. And the three things I want to look at this morning, two are based in the scripture, and one, as I was putting this together, just popped into my heart that I wanted to share. But anchor number one, verse 24, it says God. That first anchor, God. And there's some things about God that many people have different opinions and thoughts about, but for I want to share this morning some attributes of God that gives me the not only the knowledge in my mind, but the peace in my heart that God is my anchor. First of all, I want to address the person of God. God has many different attributes, and one of the ones I want to start out with is God is omnipotent, which means all-powerful. Everything hinges and depends on God. There is nothing that God does not have control over. I use the word many times in our group studies, the word sovereignty. He has the power to have control over everything, and the Bible tells us that it's not just an occasional thing, it's all the time. God has control of every situation that's going on here in our country, in this world, with the coronavirus. God has power over it, but he's allowed it to happen. Secondly, he's not only is omnipotent, he's omnipresent. There is absolutely no place in anywhere that you're not within the reach of God. Some describe it, he's a self-existing one. He's here for all eternity, from eternity past to today to eternity future. The Bible says he's the Alpha and Omega, the beginning and the end. He's also a omniscient one. He knows all things. As far as humans go, we only have so much of a capacity to have knowledge. And as we gain knowledge, we take that knowledge and apply it to our lives. Well, God is all-knowing. There's nothing outside his wheelhouse, so to speak, that he doesn't know about. So he's all-powerful, he's always present, and he's all-knowing. But a couple other things I want to share also, that he is creator. He is creator God. There is nothing that exists in anywhere that isn't outside the reach or the creative power of God. Genesis 1:1 tells us, in the beginning God created the heavens and the earth. So when you think about that God is all those things, the person of God, as a child of God, we can trust that anchor. That anchor is solid. But one other thing about God that I haven't mentioned this morning is that he is, for part of the person of God, he's holy. He's absolutely perfect. He's absolutely sinless. So anything that about the person of God, there's no such thing as anything that's false, anything that we can't rely on, or anything we can't trust, because he is holy and perfect. So there's a few things just about the person of God when it comes to talking about anchor number one, God. But secondly, the position of God. In verse number 23, it says, whose I am and whom I serve. The Apostle Paul is now making reference to the fact that God owns him. And as a child of God, we are his children. Another word that we can use for being his children is sonship. In 1 John chapter 3, verse 2, it says, beloved, now are we the sons of God. Or how about John chapter 1, verse 12? It says, but as many received him, to them gave he power to become the sons of God, even to them that believe on his name. So the position that we have as his children is, well, for lack of a better term, we are a small army, if you want to call it an army. We are small in number, but the position that we have in God is one that's just as he is perfect. He sees us as perfect because of the cross. So for every child of God, that God doesn't see our sin anymore. We commit sin. The Bible tells us that we confess our sins before him, he'll forgive us. But for how God sees his children, our position is one of clean, white as snow, because everything was paid for on the cross. He no longer sees our sin. The scriptures even tell us he casts our sin as far as the east is from the west, into the uttermost depths of the sea, and remembers them no more. The third thing about God in our scriptures is the proclamation of God. In verse number 24, and this is something that's going on today, it says, fear not. I want to emphasize the word this morning, not. Fear does not come from God. As that one scripture text I read earlier, he doesn't give us a spirit of fear, but of power and of love and of a sound mind. So when God says, fear not, he's saying that out of all the attributes that I've mentioned before, we have absolutely nothing to fear. Adrian Rogers is one of my heroes that is now in heaven. Had terminally ill cancer. It had been terminal cancer that he was going, all for all medical purposes, he was going to die. And he wrote this letter to kind of explain to not only his family but his congregation that if God chose to heal him, he would praise God and be able to serve him longer. But if he wasn't healed, then he was going to be, as the scripture says, to be absent from the body, was to be present from the Lord. He was going to go to glory. So either way, Adrian Rogers, Pastor Rogers, knew what this verse says, fear not. He didn't fear what could happen to him on this earth, and he didn't fear about death. Death has lost its sting, as it says in the scriptures. It says, O death, where is thy sting? And the sting of death has been taken away because of the cross of Jesus Christ. Now I want to share a little bit from the book of Joshua chapter 1, verses 6 through 9. And it tells us why, gives us a reason why we have nothing to fear. It says in verse 6, be strong and of a good courage, for unto this people shall thou divide for an inheritance the land which I swear unto their fathers to give them. Only be thou strong and very courageous, that thou mayest observe to do according to all the law which Moses my servant commanded thee. Turn not from it to the right hand or to the left, that thou mayest prosper whithersoever thou goest. The book of the law shall not depart out of thy mouth, but thou shalt meditate day in and night, and thou mayest observe to do exceedingly all that is written wherein, for then thou shalt make thy way prosperous, and then thou shalt have good success. And then verse 9 says, have not I commanded thee? Be strong and of a good courage. Be not afraid, neither be thou dismayed, for the Lord thy God is with thee whithersoever thou goest. That scripture text, as far as telling us what to do with fear, goes back to the attributes of God. And the fact that we can read that verse, those verses in the book of Joshua, know that they're true, and ultimately we choose whether we're going to let fear either affect us, to control us, or we're going to look fear dead in the face and say, God has said this, and he said, fear not. And then one more thing about God is the plan of God. In verse 24, it says, must be brought before Caesar. And the plan of God is for the Apostle Paul at that time, he was there from that glorious day, I'm going to call it glorious day on the Damascus Road, when God reached down and touched him with the Spirit of God, and he began to understand and carry out God's mission for him, the plan of God for his life, which was to preach Jesus Christ and him crucified, that he realized his plans were no longer in effect. Now, his plan was God's plan. And God's plan is one that's never exposed to us in a complete volume form where, okay, this is the plan of God for, put your name here, and just read through the book, and there's your plan. You've got the beginning and the end. It doesn't work that way. How it works is with the plan of God is we honor God, as we trust God and obey God, he gives us a little more direction. He lets out a little more rope to point us in the direction he wants us to go. And that's very important that all of us realize that God's plan is the best plan. It's the perfect plan. Apostle Paul knew that when he talked about just the storms just in this little bit here, but he also, if you read the book of 2 Corinthians chapter 11, talks about some of the things he went through after that Damascus Road encounter, where he had to go through beatings and stonings, imprisonment, hunger, cold, nakedness, and fear. There's fear going to be involved But ultimately, he knew that that fear would never rule his life. You and I, as children of God, at times are going to find ourselves afraid. We're going to have fear try to take over in our hearts. But where can we? What can we do? We can go right to the Word of God and it tells us to fear not. And who are we going to believe? Are we going to believe ourselves and how we interpret fear? Or are we going to believe God? And ultimately, my goal and the goal of every Bible-believing Christian is to obey God. Charles Stanley had that wonderful quote that he says, trust God and leave the consequences to Him. Just obey and trust God and leave the consequences to who? Almighty God. That's how much we can trust God. So that's just a few things about God as far as an anchor. But anchor number two I want to touch on for just a little bit is in verse 25, faith. It says in verse 25, I believe God. The Word of God is of little benefit to you and I unless we exercise faith in it. Ephesians chapter 2, verses 8 and 9 says, for by grace are you saved through faith, and that not of yourselves. It is a gift of God, not of works, lest any man should boast. And I'm going to recite verse 10 because it tells us really our position. It says, for we are his workmanship, created in Christ Jesus unto good works, which God hath before ordained that we should walk or live in them every day. But the key word is that word, faith. Faith is something, it's like the disease. We can't see it. We know it's out there, but we can't see it. Faith has the same kind of a picture to it. It says in Hebrews chapter 11, verse 1, it says, now faith is the substance of things hoped for, the evidence of things unseen. We can't see faith. So how can we say, I believe God? Or how can we say, I have faith? Because we can say that because our hearts, the Spirit of God, the Holy Spirit of God now dwells within our hearts. And when we say that I have faith in God, or I have faith in what the Word of God says, those things, the Spirit of God will confirm it, not just in our minds, but in our spirit. The Bible says that you can know that you have eternal life. How do you know that? Well, it's just something that it's, again, intangible. We can't touch it. We can't touch that faith. But we know that the Spirit of God dwells within us. And it's the Spirit of God is the one that will give you confirmation where you can say, I have faith. Paul's whole Christian life has been in the fact that he had to believe God. He had to trust God. And that every step that he took was a step that God is the one that had road that he had led him down, and he was willing to say, that's where you lead, that's where I'm going to go. And when you think about a couple of things about his Christian walk, when he and Silas were thrown into the Philippian jail, they had been beaten and threatened, and yet the Scripture tells us they still hung on to that anchor of faith. Or when he was stoned at Lystra and left for dead, he was hanging on to that anchor of faith. And as we all over the world, as people that are having to confront the coronavirus, we can say, I have faith. God knows all about it. God allowed it to happen. And that's not to be flippant about it, say that, well, I can just go where I want to go, do what I want to do, and I'll have this invisible shield of protection around us, and I'm not going to catch it. No, we have to be mindful of the fact that it's a disease, mindful of the things that we can do to limit its effect or in the contact. But ultimately, our faith isn't in medicine. Our faith has to be in God, because God is the one that gives our bodies the ability to combat disease. God is the one that gives us the doctors that are doing the research so that we can have a chance of fighting these diseases. All these things that are happening in the world today, it's all being orchestrated by God. And the level of faith that you and I have is during this time of a trial, during this time of a storm, you can look at it as why me? Or we can look at it as this is an opportunity, this is a test to see how strong my faith is. And not faith in myself, not faith in the world around me, but faith in God. Because the same faith the Apostle Paul had is the same faith that you and I have today. That Spirit of God hasn't changed. And in when I think about faith, and I read so many things that are out there that cause me, as I read them, to even maybe question faith. All these things that are happening, and I have to go back and look at, what does the Word of God say about fear? What does the Word of God say about the things that are going on in this world? And it comes back to the fact that God has it all in His hands. Everything that's happening is all in His hands, and He's got a handle on it. As long as we talked a little bit this morning about, you know, the spores and how small they are, but the Bible says that we have the faith of a mustard seed, mountains can be moved. So it doesn't take a lot of faith. It just takes having faith in the right person, God, Jesus Christ, the Holy Spirit. And the third thing that just popped into my mind, it wasn't even on my radar until about 5 o'clock this morning, but anchor number 3 is prayer. It's not in the scriptures, it's not in the text that we looked at this morning, but one thing that we can do, regardless of where we are, if we're, each one of us are confined to our homes, if we choose to do that, still pray. Online, there's a lot of different churches that are doing online prayer where you can pray with some of these other churches as they pray. That's one of the good things about social media, the good things about the internet. We can still stay connected in prayer. But one of the most important things about prayer is we can pray in private. The Bible tells us to go into our closet. Not to be the ones that want to pray to be seen by men, because Scripture says, well, they have their reward. But for you and I, as children of God, we can just go to our quiet place, get on our knees, if you can, and pray. God knows all about the situation. One thing about prayer will give God an insight into how strong your faith is. What you're praying about might be an indication of your level of faith. You might say, I don't have a lot of faith. I'm scared to death. Well, go to the Lord in prayer. As a child of God, the Spirit of God will give you something the world cannot give, and that's that word, peace. The Spirit of God will give you peace if you're spending time with Him in prayer during this trying time. So I don't know who's watching this morning, but everything that I've spoken to you about this morning hinges on one thing. Hinges on the one anchor that I haven't mentioned yet, and the anchor is Jesus Christ. You see, without a relationship, and I'm talking relationship, not talking religion, I'm not talking things that, no, I'm talking about a personal relationship with Jesus Christ. That's where your anchor has to start. If you don't know Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior, everything I've said this morning doesn't really, they're just words. There's no power behind it. But if you want to experience the attributes of God, you want to experience peace, you want to experience joy, you want to experience the power of the Spirit of God within you, then the Bible says it's very simple. We have to admit that we're sinners. We have to admit that we've fallen short of God's glory. And secondly, that wages of sin is death. What you and I deserve outside of Jesus Christ is death. But the Scripture goes on to say the wages of sin is death, but the gift of God is eternal life through Jesus Christ our Lord. So if maybe the Spirit of God is saying to you as a non-believer, however you want to call yourself, that maybe God is saying, listen, I'm the cure. I have a gift. It's called eternal life, and it's here for you if you just admit that you're a sinner. You just admit that you need Jesus Christ. And the Bible tells us it's just as simple as asking Him to come into our heart. Not just a mindset, but a heart set. Romans chapter 10, verse 9, it says, if thou shalt confess with thy mouth the Lord Jesus and believe in thine heart that God hath raised Him from the dead, the Scripture says, thou shalt be saved. It's just that simple. And my prayer this morning is, if you're a child of God, a believer in Jesus Christ, you have nothing to fear. You have the anchor of God, you have the anchor of faith, and you have the anchor of prayer. Now, there's a lot of other anchors I could go through this morning, but I thought those three are critically important for God's people to hear, but it's important for everyone to hear. The Bible says, John 3:16, for God so loved the world that He gave His only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in Him shall not perish, but have everlasting, and that last word is life. Life. Without Jesus Christ, there is no eternal life. Now, there's going to be eternal existence. Scripture does tell us, for those who reject the gift of Jesus Christ will spend an eternity separated from God in a place called hell. That's still an existence, but that's not really life. The Bible says there'll be wailing and gnashing of teeth. It's not a place I would want anybody to go. But I believe God. I believe what it says about Jesus Christ, and I believe what it says about heaven. And that's available to you this morning. Let's bow our heads for a word of prayer. Father, as you look briefly in the Scriptures this morning and talked about storms, the storms the Apostle Paul was confronting in his day, and the many storms he did encounter during his life in service to You, and Lord, the storm that we find ourselves in today, not just here in this country, but all over the world. And Father, as we looked at three anchors this morning, the anchor of God, the anchor of faith, and the anchor of prayer, Lord, I pray that your Spirit would speak to all hearts who hear this message this morning, because this is not my message, it's Your message. And I give You praise, glory, and thanks in Jesus' name. Amen.